is this thing on?
There he is! Right there! That's Butch Patrick!
Hey, the other Hollywood! I like it here. This is much better than the weird Hollywood out in the West Coast.
You're liking our Hollywood.
I like it here.
All right. Well, it's good to see you. You know, I haven't seen you in about 16 years. Let me shake your hand.
I know. 16 years ago, we did an interview. How did it go? I don't remember.
It was good.
Good.
I'm glad you were there for it. You would have been impressed.
Yeah. It was 16 years ago, I was not quite myself. I'm a lot better these days.
Actually, I got a picture to show you after all this is done. You look real good in the picture. You look the same, actually.
Well, you know, this clean living has its advantages.
Okay. Yeah. Well, yes, I
don't tell.
I'm old,
yeah, don't tell Joe.
But before we get to everything, you are a cancer survivor.
Yes, I am a cancer survivor. Let me see. September 29th, 2011 was my date of getting rid of cancer. I'm also November 21st, 2010. I got sober. Got clean and sober. So almost 5 years now, and I'm a survivor there too. So yeah, I'm feeling really good. I'm going to be around for another 20, 30 years.
All right. Well, we look forward to that. First of all, thanks for being here with us. You can see all these cameras and folks just having a great time with you.
Yeah.
What's kind of unusual to me is like to see young people know the program just as much as their parents or their grandparents know the show.
Yeah, that's what I actually did a book called Munster Memories, and its roots came from people coming up and sharing stories with me about how they enjoyed growing up with me as a kid, and now their kids and their grandkids are watching the show together. There's not a lot of shows that really have that kind of staying power, and it's kind of good wholesome shows, and we all sat down for dinner, and Herman always had a lesson to be taught to Eddie and this and that, and it's got good longevity. This is the 50th anniversary.
Right. Now see if my trivia is correct. The reason that the show was kind of wholesome and everything, because the creators of the show were the creators of one of my other favorite shows, Leave It to Beaver. Is that correct?
Yeah, Joe Connolly and Bob Mosier had done Leave It to Beaver, and one of the reasons it was an easy show for me, being the only kid, was the crew had been together for 7 years on Leave It to Beaver. So it was very kid-friendly, and all the adult cast members had children about my age. So yeah, it was a great place for a kid to be hanging out.
Right, so now if you were to compare the two shows, you were more of a Jerry Mathers kind of guy. You were the Beaver of the Munsters. But the original Eddie, which people will be shocked to know, the original Eddie, which was kind of weird, he kind of reminded me of like an Eddie Haskell kind of guy. Kind of a creepy looking dude.
Yeah, they had a kid named Happy Derman, and they also had a woman named Joan Marshall in the pilot episode. If you look at it right, you know, you can find it on YouTube or whatever. And they weren't happy with the final casting, so right before they went into production, they replaced Joan Marshall with Yvonne DiCarlo. And myself, Happy Derman went out the window, and I came in. And me and Yvonne DiCarlo tested together, and we were added to the cast like 2 days before they went into production.
Now, when Happy got the bad news, was Happy, what was he after that?
Unhappy.
You know, I don't even know. He never worked again, I don't think. And I don't know why they went through 500 kids. And for some reason, this is the Eddie that they wound up with, was a very angry little man. He was a very angry, playing it as almost like a rabid wolf boy. And they wanted, and it was funny because the guys who Leave It to Beaver, they wanted something more like a regular boy, and they really miscast this. So, you know, it was lucky for me that he was so bad, but they flew me in from Illinois, and I just went directly to the studio and had no idea that, you know, the Munsters on paper looked like, oh, this show's never going to fly. Yeah, Monsters living next door, that'll be good.
Right. It was Munsters during that day and the Addams Family.
Yes.
Munsters versus Addams Family.
Yeah.
Not because you're sitting next to me, of course. But I was a Munster. I didn't particularly care for the Addams Family. I was a Munsters kid.
Well, the Addams Family was, you know, based on Charles Addams's comic strips, or, you know, the New Yorker. Very dark humor. They were like very. In fact, a lot of people, when they get the two shows confused, I tell them, like, it's very easy to differentiate between the two. The Munsters were people that looked like monsters, and the Addams Family were monsters that looked like people.
Exactly. Except that hand that came out of the box. Well, if you're watching that at like 8 years old, I mean, you're scared looking at television, looking at that thing coming out of there.
No, it was very scary stuff. I mean, it had very dark side to it, edgy, and the Munsters were very wholesome. But the good thing about it was, we were on Thursday nights, they were on Friday nights. But what was good about it was each other's existence helped the other one, because there have never been two shows that were like in supposed competition. So it was nice to have them together, because we both kind of benefited from the other's existence.
Right. And I think a lot of people would also be surprised to know that the show only ran for two seasons.
Yeah. 70 episodes. We did 39 the first year and 31 the second. It was a very short run, but a lot of shows in the 60s had short runs that stuck around for quite a while. Star Trek comes to mind, The Honeymooners, and a few others.
Right. Of course, everybody also wants to know about the makeup. Pat Priest probably didn't have to do a lot of makeup.
No, she had it easy. She just came in and put her blonde, you know, well, she was, the first one was a brunette. Beverly Owen had to put a blonde wig on. Pat was actually a blonde, so she had it even easier. And Fred Gwynne had it the worst with his 2 hours in the morning. I only had an hour. And it was cool because if you ever seen the show Face Off, you know, with Mackenzie Westmore, well, her dad, Mike Westmore, was my makeup man as an apprentice. So I had a really good time hanging around with some of the best in the business in the lab and at the studio. When I wasn't working, I had the whole place to explore, so I had a wonderful time as a kid.
Absolutely. So it took Fred Gwynne the longest, I would think, to get ready. 2 hours.
Yeah.
I would think that that would take its toll after a while.
Luckily, we were only on, we only filmed 3 days a week, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday.
Oh my gosh.
But what really took the toll on Fred wasn't so much the makeup, it was the suit that he had to wear, because he was a very slender 6'7", and it's very hot in a soundstage, and then you put on the big padding, and it was like roasting him. So he lost, and you know, he was only like 160 pounds to begin with, a very skinny, tall guy, and he lost like a lot of weight. And he used to constantly just drink lemonade and salt tablets.
Right. Now, when you do a show like that, and of course props are very important to the program, I see you have a prop with you. Did you get a chance to take any props with you that you have today that people would just be like totally flipped out that you have?
Well, 6 years after I did the Munsters, I went out to do an Ironside at the same studio, and the prop man, lo and behold, Eddie, his name was Eddie Keyes, and he was like in his 80s when we were doing the Munsters, and he was still out there. And he flagged me down and he says, "Butch, before you leave, I want to give you something that I found in my prop box." And he gave me the original Woof Woof belt. So I wound up with Woof Woof about 6 years after the fact. And unfortunately, you know, I didn't take very good care of him, and I hung him from a noose in my bay window at the beach. And he wound up getting a bunch of sun on him, and he sort of deteriorated to where I had him restored, and I do have him still. And then recently I acquired the Von Dutch Stingray bicycle with George Barris, so I have that. It's not on display at the moment, I have it in the trailer. But I also just picked up the cars about 2 months ago, so now I have the Munster Coach and the Dracula. So we're touring the country for the next 2 years, doing as many stops as possible to meet and greet the fans, and I really appreciate y'all coming by the table. It's always nice to see Munster fans, and there's a lot of them.
Well, it's very cool. First of all, we feel so blessed today that you decided to come on out and bring the vehicles out here today, and you see there was a line of people, and there'll be a line after we're done of folks that want to shake your hand and get your picture and all that other stuff that's going on. So we're very pleased that you decided to be with us here today. Can I tell you what my favorite episode was?
Please do.
Here's my favorite episode of the Munsters was around you. It was the Zombo episode.
I knew you were going to say Zombo. That's like my favorite one too. You know, I'm glad you pointed that one out, because we had one of the successes to the show. I mean, obviously we had a good cast, but the guest stars that we had lined up to do the show, we had the best comedians in town. Louis Nye played the Zombo. We had Don Rickles as the dance instructor. We had Frank Gorshin as Fairdeal Dan. We had Richard Deacon. We had Harvey Korman did a couple of them. Paul Lynde as Dr. Dudley. I mean, the list goes on and on. So literally, we always had the best of the best writers and comedic talent coming through the show. And I think it shows in the quality of our episodes.
Absolutely, I agree. Legendary performers and guest stars in there.
Yeah, Zombo's great. I love that.
Zombo was he was like a knockoff of Bozo, except he was a creepy Bozo.
Well, the funny thing was that they showed what it was like to go on TV. So here they are, we're going to a TV studio, and I have no idea that it's all fake. And I say, "Hey, Mom, Zombo's house is really crummy." And he goes, "Eddie, this is TV. Nothing's real."
And then you tore the setup.
And I tore the setup. Yeah,
pulled his wig off.
Good episode. Really good.
It was the best.
Yeah.
All right, real quick, what's Lidsville?
Lidsville, Saturday morning, 1971, Sid and Marty Croft had approached me. They had done a show called HR Puff and Stuff, and I went out for an interview, not really wanting to do it. I was in high school, and I thought, Saturday morning TV, come on, give me a break. This is going to be silly. But there was a show called The Bugaloos, and I saw a picture of this cute little girl in The Bugaloos. And I said, "Well, if I get to meet her, I'll do Lidsville." And they said, "Well, that might work out, you know." And her name was Caroline, and I never did meet her, but we were Facebook friends. But I did this show called Lidsville. Charles Nelson Reilly played Hoodoo. Billy Hayes, who was Witchy Poo, played my sidekick, Weenie Genie. And for the summer of 71, I worked with 22 little people in Hollywood as they adorned these hats and their characters. It was crazy, psychedelic, very wacky stuff, and the funny part about it was I thought none of my friends would ever see it because they came on at 10:30 in the morning and they would all have hangovers at that time, and he'd be sleeping in. And the show wound up being on for like 4 years straight, and then it went into syndication, and then it became popular. And so now, some 46 years later, yeah, I was Mark on Lidsville, and I'm proud that I was. It was a good show.
It, absolutely, work is work. But I think, you know, did you think that it being the early 70s and what was going on during that time, the writers, and I'm telling you, that's pretty out there.
Oh, Sid, isn't it? Yeah, Sid was on psychedelics. Marty was the producer. Sid ate the pills, figured them out. Marty produced them. And then the funny part about it was that I didn't even know this. My checks came signed by Harry Croft. And I go, Sid and Marty, who's Harry? You know, where is this guy? He's supposed to be the money brother.
Oh, well, that's the guy you definitely want to get close to anyway.
Because he signed the checks.
Absolutely. Last year we had George Barris here.
Uncle George.
George was here, and he discussed at length the Munster's Coach story, the Dracula story. George is a great guy. Joe picked him up at the airport. You'll have to talk.
I heard the story.
Joe picked him up at the airport, the guy he remembered was you.
Really?
Absolutely true.
George was so nice because, you know, you gotta imagine, I'm an 11-year-old kid, and on Wednesday I had this little regimen that my mom would allow me to take a long lunch. I would get off the lot and I would go to the hobby store to get a couple pieces of slot car track for my slot car at home, a 32nd scale Strombecker. Then I would swing by George's shop and he would let me wander around and see what he was up to, and he would, Sonny and Cher's Mustangs were there, and then Elvis's Cadillacs and Frank Sinatra's stuff. So it was really a neat place, and that's when I first fell in love with cars, and George would let me be, you know, a little guy wandering around. And the neat part about it was we became friends then, and we've been friends ever since. And I consider him probably my dearest friend in Hollywood, and he knows more people than anybody.
And everybody followed him here. We had a great time. He is so down to earth and so genuine that we just had a blast with him. Joe had a blast with him the night before.
Yeah.
I happened to miss out on this, but you know, Joe took good care of him. We got him here. He remembered Butch and told the story. I mean, he was Johnny on the spot. I mean, he was unbelievable.
He's been so generous. I did a rock video once and he loaned me John Travolta's Firebird. I did another thing for a star date and we used a Munster Coach. He's very gracious and he's very easy to work with. And he just loves the fans, and taking pictures is what he loves the most. And wherever he goes, he'll have like someone with a camera documenting every step of the thing. He just can't get enough of the fans, and that's why I love him so much as well, is because I knew the family and I've known him so long.
Great guy. Yep. All right, so you're on a two-year tour. Where are you going next?
Well, 2015 is the east of the Mississippi. After this, we're going up. We're going to spend the entire month in Florida. Then we go to Pensacola, Florida. We go to Alabama, Atlanta, then I'm heading up to My Car Club, which is in New Jersey. Hopefully we might have a car show for Dead Man's Curve. Then across the Great Lakes, the Ohio Valley, and back down the Mississippi to the Gulf. And then the next year I'm starting a Route 66 tour in spring. And we're going to do the Route 66 and go all the way across country. So, you know, we'll be out and about. So if you don't live around here and you know somebody going, you know, we're heading west, just keep an eye on Munsters.com. I keep my schedule updated constantly.
Very good. Well, I don't want to keep you too long. We've got a lot of folks out here that want to meet you. I thank you so much for spending part of your morning up here. I'm going to show you this picture. Don't be afraid. It really is me.
Okay.
But everybody, once again, Butch Patrick, everybody, right here in the show film.
Happy Easter, everyone. Thanks for coming out.
All right. He'll be down at the table signing autographs and meeting everybody with the Munsters Coach and the Dracula. Everybody, once again, a big Hollywood hello to Butch Patrick, everybody.